some classes of functions that are Riemann integrable. It is sufficient for a function f to be integrable over the closed interval a comma b if it belongs to any one of the following classes of functions. Classes of function is continuous on the closed interval a comma b. Classes of functions monotonic on the closed interval a comma b. Classes of bounded functions on the closed interval a comma b with a finite set of points of discontinuity. Classes of bounded functions on closed interval a comma b with set of points of discontinuity having a finite number of limit points. Every monotonic function on the closed interval a comma b is Riemann integrable on the closed interval a comma b. Proof: we know that a function is said to be a monotonic function if it is either increasing function or decreasing function. Therefore, we'll be having two cases here. One is for increasing function. The case number two will be for decreasing function. Therefore, to show that every monotonic function is Riemann integrable, we have to show that increasing function is Riemann integrable and the decreasing function is also Riemann integrable, and hence we can conclude that every monotonic function is Riemann integrable on the closed interval a comma b. Case 1, let f be an increasing function on the closed interval a comma b. Therefore, a is less than or equal to b implies f of a is less than or equal to f of b. This is the definition of increasing function. As the values increases, its functional value also increases. Therefore, the function is an increasing function, and this is the condition for increasing function. That is, f of a less than or equal to f of x less than or equal to f of b for all x belong to the closed interval a comma b. That is, f is bounded on the closed interval a comma b. That is, the value of f of x is from f of a to f of b. Therefore, it is bounded, and infimum of the function f is f of a, and the supremum of the function f is f of b. Let epsilon be greater than 0 and p equals to the set consisting of the points x0 equal to a comma x1 comma x2 so on, xr minus 1 comma xr so on, xn equal to b, be a partition of the closed interval a comma b such that delta r is less than epsilon by f of b minus f of a plus 1, where r is equals to 1, 2, 3, so on, n. Let us call it as 1. Let small mr and capital mr be the infimum and supremum of f in ir. Then f of xr minus 1 is equals to small mr and f of xr is equal to capital mr. This is x axis, y axis. Consider this is a function which is an increasing function. This is a closed interval a comma b, and these are the points. Let us consider the rth sub interval ir. This is xr minus 1, this is xr. So this is the interval ir. If you consider the part of the curve in this closed interval ir, the minimum value is here, the maximum value is here. The minimum value is the value of the function at xr minus 1. So this is a minimum value mr. In the part of this function in this interval ir, the greatest value, the highest value, or the supremum of the function f in the interval ir is this point. That is nothing but the value of the function f at xr, which is equal to capital mr. Now look at the comparison. This graph represents a continuous function. This function represents monotonic function. The difference is the infimum and the supremum in the rth subinterval of the function f may be anywhere. In this continuous function, infimum small mr is equal to f of alpha r. Capital mr is the supremum of the function f in the interval ir, that is equal to f of beta r. And remember that alpha r and beta r need not be the endpoints of the interval ir. Whereas in the case of increasing function, those points, namely here alpha r stands for xr minus 1 and beta r stands for xr, and these two points xr minus 1 and xr must be the end points of the subinterval ir. Here alpha r and beta r need not be the end points of ir, whereas xr and xr minus 1 must be the end points because it is an increasing function. Whereas if we see the continuous curve, it is neither increasing nor decreasing, because here it is decreasing, then it is increasing. Therefore, the two points alpha r and beta r may be from the interval xr minus 1 to xr. But here the infimum must be the value of the function at xr minus 1. Here the supremum is the value of the function at xr, where xr minus 1 and xr are the end points of the interval ir. Now our aim is to show that the given function f, which is an increasing function, is Riemann integrable. To show that the function f is Riemann integrable, we have to show that the difference of UPF and LPF is less than epsilon. Therefore, consider u of p comma f minus l of p comma f. The value of u of p comma f is sigma r equal to 1 to n capital M r into delta r minus L of p comma f is sigma r equal to 1 to n small mr into delta r, where small mr and capital mr are the infimum and supremum of the function f in the rth subinterval, and delta r is the length of the rth subinterval. That is equals to sigma r equal to 1 to n capital mr minus small mr into delta r. That is, we are taken delta r out. That is equals to sigma r equal to 1 to n f of xr minus f of xr minus 1 into delta r, because the value of capital mr is f of xr, the value of small mr is f of xr minus 1. That is equals to sigma r equal to 1 to n f of xr minus f of xr minus 1 into delta r. What is the value of delta r? Delta r value is less than epsilon by f of b minus f of a plus 1. Therefore, now we are going to replace the value of delta r, which is less than epsilon by f of b minus f of a plus 1. Therefore, here this equal sign will be replaced by less than. Hence, delta r is less than epsilon by f of b minus f of a plus 1. Now what is the value of sigma r equal to 1 to n f of xr minus f of xr minus 1? To get this value, we are going to keep the value of r equals to 1, 2, 3 up to n, sigma r equal to 1 to n f of xr minus f of xr minus 1 is equals to, now put r is equal to 1. When you keep r equal to 1, f of xr becomes f of x1. When you keep r equal to 1, r minus 1 becomes 1 minus 1, 0. Therefore, f of x0 plus, because we have summation, we write plus here. Now put r is equals to 2. Therefore, it becomes f of x2 minus f of x2 minus 1. That is f of x1 plus, now put r equal to 3. Then this becomes f of x3 minus, this becomes f of x2 plus, now put r is equals to 4. Therefore, it becomes f of x4 minus f of x3, so on. Now put r is equal to n minus 1. Therefore, it becomes f of x minus 1 minus f of xn minus 2 plus, now put the last value, namely r is equals to n, then it becomes f of xn minus f of xn minus 1. If you look at these terms, here you can see f of x1 minus f of x1. So these two get cancelled. Then f of x2 minus f of x2 get cancelled. Similarly, f of x3 minus f of x3 get cancelled, so on. Here f of xn minus 1, f of xn minus 1 get cancelled, so on. Finally, we will get f of xn minus f of x0. What is f of xn? What is xn value? Xn value is b. What is x0 value? X0 value is a. Therefore, f of xn is equal to f of b minus f of x0 is f of a. Thus, the value of the sum is f of b minus f of a. Therefore, the above expression is equals to f of b minus f of a into epsilon by f of b minus f of a plus 1. That is equal to epsilon by f of b minus f of a by f of b minus f of a plus 1. Now let us find the value of f of b minus f of a by f of b minus f of a plus 1. It is clear that f of b minus f of a plus 1 is greater than f of b minus f of a. F of b minus f of a is positive value. We are adding 1 to the left hand side. Therefore, the left hand side is greater than the right hand side. And this can be written as f of b minus f of a is less than f of b minus f of a plus 1. Now bring this f of b minus f of a plus 1 to the left hand side. Therefore, f of b minus f of a by f of b minus f of a plus 1 is less than 1. Thus, the value of this expression is less than 1. Therefore, it is equals to, that is, this expression is equals to epsilon into, its value is simply less than epsilon. Therefore, this equality is replaced by less than. So, less than epsilon. Thus, u of p comma f minus l of p comma f is less than epsilon. That is, f is Riemann integrable. Case 2. Let us consider the function f be a decreasing function on the closed interval a comma b. This implies, since f is a decreasing function, minus f is an increasing function on the closed interval a comma b. Just now we have shown that every increasing function is Riemann integrable. Since minus f is one of the increasing functions which must be Riemann integrable, therefore minus f belongs to R of a comma b. This is by case number 1. Since minus f is a Riemann integrable, then the upper Riemann integral of minus f is equals to lower Riemann integral of the function minus f. That is, integral from a to b bar minus f is equal to integral a bar to b minus f. Also, we know that upper Riemann integral of minus f is equals to minus of lower Riemann integral. Similarly, the lower Riemann integral of minus f is equals to minus of upper Riemann integral. Therefore, the next step is minus of a to b bar f is equal to minus a bar to b f. Now, cancel this minus sign on both sides. We get integral from a to b bar f is equals to integral a bar to b f. That is, upper Riemann integral of the function f is equal to lower Riemann integral of the function f. What is the function f? The function f is a decreasing function. That is, the function f is Riemann integrable. And this decreasing function is Riemann integrable. Case 1 says that every increasing function is Riemann integrable. Case 2 says that every decreasing function is Riemann integrable on the given closed interval a comma b. Therefore, we conclude that every monotonic function on the closed interval a comma b is Riemann integrable on the closed interval a comma b. Examples: f of x is equal to x squared is an increasing function on the closed interval a comma b, where 0 less than a less than b, and so x squared is integrable on the closed interval a comma b, and f of x is equal to 1 by x is a decreasing function on the closed interval 1 comma 2, and so the decreasing function 1 by x is integrable on the closed interval 1 comma 2. Why should we take delta r is less than epsilon by f of b minus f of a plus 1? The reason is, our aim is to show that the difference of upper dot box sum and the lower dot box sum is less than epsilon. How do you get less than epsilon? Up to here, the value is same. When we calculate upper Riemann integral minus lower Riemann integral, we get this sum is f of b minus f of a into delta r. Now our aim is to get less than epsilon. Since this sum is f of b minus f of a, to get epsilon, we have to take delta value is equal or less than epsilon by f of b minus f of a. But here we have taken epsilon by f of b minus f of a plus 1, so that we get directly its value is less than epsilon. The value of f of b minus f of a by f of b minus f of a plus 1 is less than 1, and hence we get this is less than epsilon. To make the difference of upper Riemann lower Riemann less than epsilon, we are taking delta r value is less than epsilon by f of b minus f of a plus 1.